Okay. Let me kick off by saying it's always fun to listen to a talk by Michelle. She and I do a fair amount of work together, as I mean, read, but every time she gives a talk, I change what I want to say. because she twists this to my brain and mixes it up, and since I write every talk extemporaneously, I'm going to let her change the talk. So I'm Bob McGwire. I'm N4YH. I was born in southwest Alabama in a little bitty town. I was born in Alabama, but moved to southwest Alabama in a little bitty town called Grove Hill in Clark County. And when I was very young, I was really precocious. I was just, I almost drove my mother crazy. And my father bought a CB radio, and he loved it. So he put it on the air. And so I'm 9 years old, and every time he goes off away, I turn on the CB radio and I drive everybody on every channel crazy. So W4WPV and K4TSN call him up, and I say both of them are passed away, good, because they were illegally using CB radios to run their business. So they're both passed away, so I think it's okay to say. Of course, everybody else was back then. And I just was driving them crazy. They could barely keep their businesses going. So they told my dad to bring me down and let them teach me ham radio, which they did. And they Elmered me through my novice. One of them had an unbuilt DX40 kit, and I built the DX40. One of them had a dusty cobweb-filled Hammerlin HQ110A1. And I had to repair it because the electrolytics was shot and half the tubes didn't work. But I learned how to do that. So at 10 years old, I became enamored with radio and spectrum. And it has defined the remainder of my life. So that was 1964. And today, I still do radio from the time I get up till I go to bed. But you have no idea what radio will be in 5 years. By the end of this talk, I assure you, you will be shocked. I don't think anyone of you has sufficient experience yet to truly understand what's going to happen. But you use what I'm going to tell you about every single day now, because all these people in this room are technical. Every one of you has a smartphone, and every one of you does searches, or you translate or whatever. And how are those things done? How do the services that do these searches for you translate things? How is it done? Nope. No, that's how the question gets to them. Right now, this is not about radio. What is the computer doing?
Search engine.
It's not, but there's a special thing that's going on in the search engine.
Sharding.
No. What is the overall thing that's happening? Big overall umbrella of all the same.
Indexing.
No, that's not quite it. They are indexing, but they don't know how to take your jumbled up query and
vote.
Huh? Well, how are they voting?
Because by ranking.
It learns.
Okay, you said it. It learns. So you got it. Dave got it. This is why I use the Socratic method, because it's machine intelligence. There are no humans involved in your Google search or your look for or your routing of your car to a different route by Google Maps. So Google and Facebook and Microsoft, these people, they are exploding onto the world machine intelligence. So much of Michelle's talk was about how things are kind of done now and how things are thought about in the past, like Guy and others. I'm going to tell you why it's gone. That will just be totally washed away in a tidal wave, and I will get there. Okay. I am on the faculty at Virginia Tech. I am in the Hume Center, which is the Ted and Karen Hume Center for National Security and Technology. Ted was in the Science and Technology Division of the Central Intelligence Agency for much of his career. He retired. When he retired from the Central Intelligence Agency, he started a company. The company did extremely well and was bought out by Kinetic. And when he got his money from Kinetic, he from his position in science and technology at the CIA and his overview of DOD and the intelligence community, he realized we have a really, really serious problem. You cannot outsource classified contracts to China or India. Okay, so he asked Charles Clancy and me to come to Virginia Tech, and we started up the Hume Center with Ted's money. We had to earn our own way. The students are supported by Ted's money. The goal is, what do you think the number one problem right now in getting a student to go into science, technology, engineering, and math and work for the intelligence community of the DOD or one of its contractors? What do you think is the number one problem? No, that's a citizen.
Preparation,
competition. But why don't they prepare?
Competition.
What? I'm sorry? No, it's not fear. It's not fear. That's not the real reason. It's
because...
No, actually, almost everyone's primary education prepares them, but there's another way that their parents are unable to prepare.
Financing.
The number one reason kids choose anything to go into in college is to pay off those bloody loans they take off to go to school. Many of you are too old, or maybe you have children, and you know they're largely taking out loans to go to college. And when you go to work for the intelligence community or the DOD, you're not making enough money to pay those loan backs until almost your children are ready to go to college. Okay, so that's a real problem. Ted and Karen wanted to stop that. So we find undergraduate students that got some of this, that may be able to talk into doing science, technology, engineering, and math, and going on and doing the IC and DOD work. We don't make them, but they can. And we're finding that many of them do just by being around those of us who do that kind of stuff. And it's working. So I have 100 students involved in technical work and 150 involved in growth. So it's like 250 or 300 students involved in the Ted and Karen Hume Center. A lot of them want to go to work for the CIA. A lot of them want to do interesting work. But actually, they don't care about making a lot of money. They actually are like you and me and others. They care a whole lot about this tinkering around and figuring out what they can do with stuff. And money is not their primary objective. We are distorting that. We are distorting their desire to do this for making money by have them getting tons and tons of loans that it takes forever to pay back. So Ted and Karen Hume realized this. I didn't realize it. I'm going to tell you, I just didn't realize it. But Ted and Karen Hume did, and so they wanted to end it, and they've done a good thing. All right. So at Virginia Tech, an interesting thing I didn't know when I went there. I had no idea what some of the things I would do after I went there. So almost immediately, I realized that I could start companies from there. They would let me figure out some things, work out an agreement with them, and take what I had figured out and go off and start a company. So the first one I did was Federated Wireless. Federated Wireless is, what is it doing? Spectrum sharing. So, and it is doing a bunch of the things that Michelle was talking about in spectrum sharing with the thing, but coupled with it is the thing I questioned you about with Google, Facebook, etc. So Michelle told you about time division, multiplexing, frequency division, multiplexing, spatial, all these times multiple access, and I've got sensors. They are coupled with these little cells, which are about that big. They have a piece of fiber optics that runs back to a computer, and in that computer is machine intelligence. The machine intelligence is in total, complete, absolutely total control of this. And I don't even teach it how to work. I have almost nothing to do with how it learns what's the right thing to do with these cells. It does a thing called reinforcement machine learning. So what it does is I say, here's what I'd like for you to do, and here's how you reward yourself. It's a metric inside. So it has a metric, and the metric, if it goes up, it's happy. If it goes down, it's unhappy. So it doesn't try the strategies it had before if its metric goes down. If it does a strategy in which the metric goes up, it rewards itself by doing it more and more. So Federated Wireless will put out little cells about that big, called SYNQs, C-I-N-Q, and they will be 3.55 gigahertz. And you're not going to believe how really stupid, simple, easy the idea was. And Michelle hinted at it while she was talking. That actually makes Federated Wireless work. That's in a band with radars. Spin 43, satellite, Earth to satellite, fixed satellite service stuff is there. So we had to figure out a way around it. So Spin 43 radar, which was the principal objection to that band being given away to wireless companies, it is an old-style radar. It spins around on the top of the ships. You've seen it spin around on top of the ships, and it puts out lots of pulses, and it's easy to detect these pulses from almost 100 miles away. You don't need to detect them, all of them. You need to just detect them every now and again. If you get enough of the every now and again, you go over some threshold and you go, oops, the Spin 43 radar is here. Now what do you do that you found the Spin 43 radar? How does 4G LTE work? When your phone turns on, it's dumb. It's a complete moron. All it does is change the channel. Changes the channel. While it's changing the channel, it's looking for the cellular infrastructure. Once it finds the cellular infrastructure, it says, is that cellular infrastructure available to me to use in my phone to communicate with whoever I want to? And so it makes a connection. So the thing I figured out was, if I hear the Spin 43 radar, turn the infrastructure off, and the phone goes away. Well, believe it or not, no one in the 3.55 gigahertz problem had realized how utterly trivially simple that was. So for the use of 3.55 gigahertz sharing with between radar and 4G LTE, I patented it. And that patent is blocking on almost everyone else who wants to work in that market. So just two stupid, simple idea, but realizing how everything worked allowed me to do it. And then other smart people came in, and the cells will be in the windows and the ceilings and the walls, and machine intelligence will decide which ones to turn on and off, and it'll be on demand. So it's utterly dynamic, totally unplanned. Throw them in the building, turn on the machine, its intelligence will figure out how to use it. And not one piece of planning will be done. There, you will not have a survey in the building. So why? Why won't the survey work? Because you might put up a wall tomorrow. You know, you might totally change your interior. You can't plan this because it's your building. You can do whatever you want inside your building. So you got to have enough of these to figure out. And the only way to do it later, you're not going to let me tear the walls out to go redo the cells. I mean, that's really, really expensive. So how about going around it? So the machine will figure out which ones to turn off, how much power it should run, and all of that other stuff. Okay, so that also led, a bunch of ideas there, led to the next collection of ideas, which came from both my previous experience and some of the things you have talked about here, which are interference. And where are the interferers? Where are the users? Where are they? We do need to know where the transmitters are, so if we know where our receiver is, we can say which one is interfering with us, using us, whatever. And so I started Hawkeye 360. And Hawkeye 360 is a satellite using company, and the satellites are going to fly over and do a geolocation on emitters. And I came up with an idea. The idea was how to do some interesting mathematics that made the geolocation things extremely effective, more effective than others had done. And using smaller satellites, cheaper satellites, and some smart math, but using new technology. New technology was the thing that enabled the old ideas to be applied in a new way, and so that will allow us to find interferers. If technology goes where I predict it will go, I will be able to find any emitter on the ground within a couple of meters between 50, 60 megahertz and 6 gigahertz. Because I have the effect, mathematically, I have the equivalent of a 60 dB gain antenna in low Earth orbit. It's, mathematically, it's the equivalent. Okay, so, because the processing gain is 60 dB. So I literally can have a tiny, tiny, tiny beam. And the rest of the stuff, how you do it, how you use it, well, I won't go into it, because now I'm going to jump back to this. But Michelle redirected my talk by bringing that stuff up. Okay, so, because I hadn't thought about telling you about those companies. But now I'm going to go into the history of radio and spectrum. This is so much more boring than what Michelle did, but that's okay. Let's get through it. Okay, so lots of events and discoveries, which we will call physics, happened in the 1880s and before. And what to call things when radio was first found and understood, they called it electromagnetic radiation, electric waves, ether waves, spark telegraphy, space telegraphy, aerography, and wireless. Then atomography was an attempt to have all people agree on one name, and that failed because we don't call it atomography. So telegraphy and telephony were names coined by Frederick Collins. That's actually pretty good because they were used a lot. Telegraphy meant by wire, and telephony meant wireless. And that was in 1901. Wondered whether the question might become academic, and it did. Wireless and radio were wondered about. Is there a difference between them? They decided, nope. Then Guglielmo Marconi experimented with the practical engineering done by all these physicists and other people doing these weird experiments, and found he could transmit a spark and receive his spark gap transmitter. So he first used to keep up with royal races, boat races in England, and it impressed them. It impressed them so much that the royals and the Navy decided, shoot, we better put this on our Navy ships because we need to be able to talk to them, because there's lots of fog and other things that happen around the British Isles. So occasionally you get rough seas in the North Sea. So they figured this would be a neat thing to have it on ships. So they built, had Marconi put a big radio site on the Isle of Wight. So by 19, that made progress, and then kind of a big deal happened. 1899, the world was catching on when two stations connected between England and France, and we realized that we had a way to wireless communicate internationally. So this is the spark gap transmitter invented by Marconi. There are some batteries. There's your telegraphy key. And here is a big induction coil, because when you open and close an electric circuit on an inductor, it lets go of a lot of back EMF, so a very, very high voltage is generated with that instantaneous closure and opening, that instantaneous closure and opening, with a very high voltage across these two terminals right here. Very high, and it's very densely wound. You don't really need a lot of current, you just need big voltage so you have a breakdown. And that big voltage causes a breakdown between those two points, and there's a spark. So when the spark happens, that's a current, but now this is a closed circuit. And the Leyden jars, what are they? Capacitors. And this is obviously a coil. So what is this thing? Tuned circuit. It's an LC tuned circuit. Now, you notice that the capacitor is tapped here, and the other thing is tapped here, but this thing he calls arrows tapped up here. So what else is this coil doing? Impedance matching. So it was already understood then that the right way to do connection of a transmitter to an aerial was to have the maximum power transfer when the input impedance is the same as the output impedance is the same as the input impedance to the antenna. So he didn't have a clue what to call it. He just moved the tap up and down till he had the maximum signal. But what he was doing was impedance matching. Okay, so this is the super-duper simple thing that Marconi put together that is why we're all here. He had the first patents, and this is a big, huge deal. So in 1895, he began building his wireless telegraphy system. He called Hertzian waves. It's what electromagnetic waves were called. And don't think it was only done in Britain or in Italy. No, Alexander Popov demonstrated transmission of signals between buildings using something like a spark gap, similar principle in St. Petersburg.
Right here?
Yeah, right here in St. Petersburg, Russia. 1897, he was awarded his British patent for the telegraphy transmitter. And he figured, shoot, I'm going to get rich. So he built that permanent radio station on Isle of Wight, which the Navy used, which I told you about. That was 1897. Then he knew he was going to get rich because the Navy and the government was going to buy it. So 1898, he opened a radio factory, and he began manufacturing wireless telegraphy radios. But telegraphy is difficult. It's hard. I mean, how many of you want to run out today and renew your amateur radio license with Morse code? And how many kids do you know? You do, and I do. I'm like Brennan, I'm a CW contester, so I still do it. But anyway, a lot of kids don't want to do Morse code. They want to do other things. Believe it or not, they don't even want to do voice. But back then, there wasn't the internet, so the next thing was voice. And Reginald Fessenden made a weak transmission of voice in 1900. So 1901, Marconi claims he heard St. John's, Newfoundland and Cornwall, UK. And that was transatlantic. So that's a great, big, huge deal. And in 1904, the United States Patent Office agreed that Marconi was the first and grants Marconi a patent to do radio. Later on, after World War II, you know, on occasion, the government can be kind of a jerk because they didn't want to have to pay Marconi a ton of money for their use of radio for 35 years and everything they did. So they kind of cut off some of the applications of his patent in what I consider to be a really ugly incident. But Marconi is still known as the inventor of radio. He has just not received all the awards he should have. And who else did not receive all the awards they should have that all, I bet everyone in here knows? Armstrong. We'll get to that. We'll get there. Ernest Fisk transmits music in Australia in 1906. So that was a big deal because that was the first music transmission over the air. I mean, you know, the whole world caught on. You know, sometimes we get kind of focused and centric and think we're like everything, but there are bright people all over the world, and this stuff took off in like 10 years and was everywhere. Okay, so 1960, let's go back to the U.S. for a minute. 1960, 9XM, now WHA, delivered the weather in Wisconsin by voice and other ways. 1919, a clear transmission of speech over radio was done at the same Wisconsin radio station, 9XM. 1920, broadcast started all over the world because there's a spark, and it's done by a key opening and a key closing. So you know what instantaneously happens when you open and close a key. You've heard it on 20-meter band. It's called key clicks. What exactly is a key click? What does that mean? It's wide band. So here is a basic, Tim, you're cheating. Here's a basic fundamental fact that we now know is easily described by the mathematics of how to look at time and frequency around these signals. If something changes very abruptly in time, it's very wide. If something changes very, very slowly in frequency, it is very long in time. So they are inversely related, and you see that with a mathematical tool called a Fourier transform. So if it's narrow here and you Fourier transform, it's wide. If it's wide and you Fourier transform it, it's narrow. They are kind of inversely coupled. And what branch of physics does that remind you of? Yeah, you keep cheating. He's smart. He's just smart, that's it. So the Fourier transform is at the heart of quantum mechanics. And Planck's constant is this business of the frequency is narrow, the time is long, the time is narrow, the frequency is wide. they are the same. Momentum and all that's energy and all those things, they are kind of these Fourier transform-based relationships. And the Fourier transform is involved because, oh, dear. Okay, I walked into this, didn't I? Okay, so the quantum mechanics is described best by an infinite dimensional description. And so I'm going to give you an analogy that I think will help, to help how weird quantum mechanics is. It's really weird. So let's go to a hotel. This is a special hotel because Hilbert is running the hotel. And Hilbert is behind the desk. And in this hotel, there's an infinite number of rooms. And every one of them are full. So the door opens. Somebody comes in and says, I'd like a room. And Hilbert says, my hotel is full. And the person turns and talks away and says, no, that's not a problem. No, don't worry about it. I'll tell the person in the first room to go to the second room. Person in the second room to go to the third room. Person in the third room to go to the fourth room. All the way down the line, and the person that just came in goes in room number one. Now, that's pretty easy to get. Now, it really gets weird. You and an infinite number of friends decide to go to the full Hilbert Hotel. It's full. Infinite number of friends come in and say, Dr. Hilbert, we want rooms. And the Hilbert says, oh, we're full, but don't worry. I'll take the first person in room one and put them in room two. I'll take the person in room two and put them in room four. I'll person in room three and put them in room six, and on and on and on, okay? So I just took an infinite number of people in the infinite hotel, slid them all down two rooms, and now the infinite number of people all have rooms. Quantum mechanics is weird. It's just really weird. Okay, but it's Fourier transform that we all think of and know. We know about key clicks and wide band and narrow band and long time is all the same as quantum mechanics. I hope that kind of helps you if you ever think about that crazy stuff. Okay. Let's see. So, spark gap stopped. The reason I jumped to wide band, narrow band is the reason it stopped is because that wide band excitation was clobbering everything that was on the air. I mean, you put a very high power spark gap and it blocked out a ton of spectrum. Here we go. We needed spectrum reuse, and the way to do that is tell this spectrum gobbler to turn off. So that was a you get away, you go. And how many spark gap transmitters were there in the world then? Okay, so there were a lot of them. It was the only way, and they all got turned off. Okay, so 1921, classical music was transmitted. You Australians just love your music, don't you? Yeah, okay. So classical music was transmitted for the first time in Australia on 214 kilohertz. And a frequency assignment was made by the Australian government. So now the government is involved in deciding who can be on what frequency. That is the first instance of spectrum management by any government in the world. Up until then, it was like whoever built the transmitter, that was their channel. So 9XM, they just put it up. They got a bunch of junk out of the closet, put it together, and it worked. So that's where they parked, wherever they were. Okay. Vacuum tubes, 1920s, triode amplifier, AM television. Television was transmitted in 1920s. Isn't that amazing? 1930s, single sideband FM were invented by amateur radio operators, which included Howard Armstrong, but he tested with those. He tried to use it commercial by 1940. He had some problems with other people not honoring his work. I wasn't going to name him a name, but it was Sarnoff. And Howard Armstrong... you're right. You're right. Sorry. Okay. Yeah, it's Edward Howard. Yes, that's right. That's right. It's E. Howard Armstrong. That's right. Thanks for correcting me, though. He couldn't tolerate stress and pressure, and he decided to take a long dive off of a tall building. That was really, really sad. Okay, so, but look, I'm sorry. Yes, John.
Yeah. Just actually, I was rummaging through the Bell Systems Technical Journal a while ago and discovered sideband was actually used in 1926 for the first transatlantic phone circuit, 60 kilohertz.
Yep.
And it grew out of the multiplexing that the phone company started in the, actually in the 19-teens. So sideband goes back way the hell further than...
That's interesting. That's interesting. I didn't know that. Thank you for correcting me. So I bought it. I think hams are more important than anybody anyway. But look, in the late 1920s and 30s, single sideband and FM took off, and E. Howard was the inventor of FM. And he did super heterodyne receivers and a bunch of other stuff. So he was critically important to kind of everything that's followed on, even if he was cheated out of what he was owed. It should be concerning to you. I know it is to me. Should be concerning to you, and I know it is to me, that our favorite modes stopped being invented and became widely used by 1940. That is a long time before we have a tidal wave sweep over amateur radio. The modern tidal wave that's swept over amateur radio is what is in every ham radio shack now besides a radio?
Computer.
That is the tidal wave that has swept over us, and it is going to bring us back to being technical innovators, and I'm going to probably the leading edge. We are uniquely situated to being the leading edge in radio again, and I will get there. Yes, Guy.
Yeah, it was just a minor point. It was a minor point about Edwin Armstrong. He was very litigious in defending and offending people with his patents, and when he did finally die, his widow settled all those cases favorably and usually on the terms that were originally offered Armstrong at the very beginning.
Okay.
So it's another sad case of, the brilliant guy just really a nutcase.
Yep. So I could tell you my approach to this. This is a personal thing. I would never do what Armstrong did. And so how many people in here know anything about venture capitalists? Right. You love them? Yeah, exactly. You love them on day one, and you hate them later. Okay. So they're called vulture capitalists. But I'm 62, so I went into it, and I went, I'll start these companies. I'm going to make some money. It's more than I had when I walked in. The vulture capitalists are going to take a big chunk of it, and I just live with it. So I get what I get, and it's more than what I had. So I had really good ideas, and we're all going to make money, but they're going to make a lot more than I do. Okay, but it's just the way it is. E. Howard was not able to face this. He really wanted them to kind of bow down and kiss his feet, and it just didn't work. Okay, so that's kind of a sad part of our history, but yeah. Okay, so look, there's some interesting things on this page. This is tiny print, so I'm sorry. I probably should have made it bigger, but let me go through it. 1954, the transistor radio was developed. 1960, Sony built the first pocket transistor radio. 1963, we had color TV. 1970s, we had the radio location from Loran for radio navigation. 1973, DARPA started the ARPANET and packet radio, and that became packet radio as we know it and the internet. So 1980, amateur began packet radio. What country was it begun in?
Canada.
That's right. Okay, so in 1983, it moved down to California, and then a bunch of folks in Tucson, Arizona, got together, and TAPR produced the first TNC using AX25. So there's a common theme now that will go on through here. This is the place where K3IO began impacting my life. Okay, and that's Tom Clark. At the time, he was W3IWI. So he talked me into this interesting group in TAPR at Tucson. You should be involved. So after the first TNC was produced, but before the second TNC was produced, I joined TAPR. So I was in the first 22 dozen members of TAPR. I was not in the first class. I was in the second class. Making me a second-class citizen. Okay, but that's not the way they look at it. I'm being facetious. Okay, but this right here is a big deal to amateur radio. It is the first completely dedicated, using computers, digital to digital, file transfer, et cetera, that, and all, you didn't care what it was. You had no, you didn't care what went over the air. It was data, binary encoding of your data. This is where it started in amateur radio, this zero and one, because we had kind of digital machines before, but they were radio teletype or Morse code. Okay, so this is the first ASCII is the characters, computers are involved in the construction of this. So these are the major changes here. And a bunch of us like really inspired. It was really, really fascinating. And we innovated. So I'm going to go over that. 1987, GPS was launched by DOD so it could provide navigation, location to everyone in the military. And they kept one of the channels super duper secret. And for the rest of us, we couldn't do as well as they could. They wanted for adversaries not to be able to use GPS to do guided munitions. So they spoiled it for those who are not in the military. And later on, we gave that up because it turned out it was a whole lot more important for commercial activities. And it just started whole industries, billions of dollars of impact. So DOD and the government in the United States decided to give up. I do not believe they will ever turn on selective availability again for any reason. And Galileo in the European Union, they've assured that that will never happen. But they didn't trust us. They did not trust us to never turn on selective availability again. And they're up. Okay, so 1980s, this is may look self-centered, but it isn't. I mean, TAPR and AMSAT were the reasons. And, you know, necessity is the mother of invention. We did in TAPR and AMSAT what we needed to do, and that's why Tom and I started the TAPR AMSAT DSP project. And AMSAT needed digital signal processing for its deal, and we needed digital signal processing for that. People in TAPR are viewing way ahead. I already told you about Mike Parker who started Rencon. He was doing DSP, but on big computers. Then KA9Q, Phil Karn, he begins NOS, TCP/IP. So Byrne, that's Dave, Karn and I began over-the-air experimentation in New Jersey on TCP/IP, including how to hop your IP connection from one AX25 DigiPeter to another AX25 DigiPeter. What did that allow? Network, but what else did it allow? What do these things do? No, what do these things do? They frequency hop or cell hop. So the cell hop is like an AX25 DigiPeter, and that's called mobile IP. You're looking at the beginning of mobile IP in New Jersey. Two goofball hams working with one of the big geniuses, okay? Mobile IP was done here by Phil Karn. Yeah?
I think you should mention Hedy Lamarr.
Oh, I should. Yeah, I did. So Hedy Lamarr, who everybody knows, the famous actress, Qualcomm loves Hedy Lamarr. She's got to be their hero because Andy Viterbi took Hedy Lamarr's invention and made it into CDMA. Hedy Lamarr invented spread spectrum.
She invented frequency hopping.
Yeah, but she also did direct. She and another guy in that bureau did direct. That was a secret then. They did multiple ways of spread spectrum, but she knew you needed to spread the energy out in frequency. It came here because you wanted to avoid being jammed. And she did, so the one that became known because it was easy to do at the time was the frequency hopping. The other thing that she wrote down in her lab was CDM, was spread spectrum. She did both forms of spread spectrum, frequency and time. She was very, very bright. Thank you for reminding me of that. That would have been really bad to overlook. Okay. All right. So I began working on the DSP2232 multimode for AEA. And the reason I began doing it is the TAPR AMSAT DSP project was kind of stalled. Who knows why it was stalled?
It was about the name?
I'm sorry?
About the name, AMSAT?
No, no. So AMSAT was involved. So why was the TAPR AMSAT DSP project stalled? Because AMSAT and TAPR took their focus off of it. What did they do?
Watch Friends.
Nope. Nope. That's a good answer, but that's not it. No, they decided to build a packet radio satellite bulletin board system, and we stopped doing DSP in that group, and we started doing PacSat. So we built the microsats, starting about 1987. Phil Karn, myself, Tom Clark. I mean, you get the idea. We were in a hotel room in Detroit at AMSAT meeting, and we sat down probably with a little too much liquid refreshment, and we drew pictures on a piece of paper, and we said, hey, we can build a spacecraft, and we're just crazy enough to have pulled it off. Okay, so microsats were launched in 1991 on Ariane 3 carrying Spot 2. The other thing that went on there is we had to have a European partner or they wouldn't give us a ride. So we partnered up with Martin Sweeting at the University of Surrey, and Jeff Ward and I spent 2 months in Toulouse at Matra, where we engineered the platform on which the 6 spacecraft would sit, and after the big payload went off, our little spacecraft would be popped off. So what was born that day? No, no, it was before that. But how did the microsats get up?
They were on a ring.
And that ring began the commercial secondary launch industry. We did it first. And again, this is not great genius. It was the only way they were going to let us do this. So necessity was the mother of invention. We didn't have a clue we were first. We had no clue. We were just doing what was necessary. We were engineers doing our job. But that was the first time anybody had taken a platform designed for secondary payloads, and after that they sold launches on it. That was the first commercial secondary. So amateur radio had a big impact there. Okay, so on the DSP-2232, which I decided to do with AEA because everybody else was stalled doing something else, I was the architect for the DSP-2232, and I had 2 friends who were not involved directly in AMSAT, Brooks, KB2CST, and Pat, KA2MOV. Brooks did the firmware for the Z80, and KA2MOV did all the board layout and manufactured prototype boards, and AEA bought it. So it became a multi-mode radio, and it could do hundreds of different modems, and that was in 1988 and 9. We changed the modems, updated them. But I said, you know, these modems, I'm doing all, many of you now know it was an everyday thing, IQ processing. That's what was in the DSP-2232. It was IQ processing. The entire mathematics was done in complex numbers, and it was IQ processing. And I said, you know, you can do single sideband, FM, and CW, and digital, and everything else. I says, I can write any one of these modes in software. So I went to AEA in 1989, and I asked them, would they let me do a software-based radio? I told them how it would work. They made me stand there a week and explain every step to them, but they got it. Yeah, 1 second. And the AEA failed because George Buxton died of Hodgkin's lymphoma, which was a very bad thing. George was the business manager of the company, and Mike Lamb was kind of the visionary. And without George, the company just couldn't run. Mike was distraught. His friend had died, and the company just went fallow. So the first proposed software radio was never built. Never built. Okay, so 1990s, amateur used personal computers to send and receive digital modes through sound card modems. We were doing software radio from the beginning. We were intimately involved with the birth of software radio. Okay, so, I'm sorry?
What year?
1989 and 1990, we were doing software radio. And Joe Mottola wrote his paper in 1991. We were before Joe Mottola. Now, that doesn't mean we were first, because we're a bunch of hams hacking around. we were co-inventors, if you will, because you know who was already doing software radio. The Pentagon and the government, they were doing it already, but we didn't know that. So, you know, they weren't telling anybody. So about the same time, E-Systems and others were doing it, but in secret. And theirs cost a whole lot more money. Okay, so the DSP thing we used, there was this guy in the District of Columbia, and he had this board called Delanco Spry, and we went over to his house to talk him into selling two of them to Tom and me. And he opened the door to his garage, pulled all his junk out of the way, walked in and got these two plug-in boards that plugged into ISA slots in your computer, and we started our work. Okay, so Tom and I did the first proof that you could take a weak signal with digital signal processing, bounce it off the moon, and be heard on 435 megahertz with a small antenna and 100 watts. So Phil Karn, after that, came up with Tom with a mode of transmission that allowed you to do digital. And Joe Taylor took that mode and used it into JT65, but he realized something that we did not realize from experimentation. He needed to give half of the power to synchronization. You need to be on what frequency and what time the signals are on and where they start in order to be able to decode it. So it was Tom and I, Phil and Tom, Joe Taylor that put it all together and made it work. Okay. So in 1993, Mottola wrote his PhD thesis in Europe proposing cognitive radio. He was absolutely the first. None of the rest of us were doing cognitive radio. And the reason is we didn't have big enough computers, so we couldn't do it. So necessity and need and having access to the toys led us to do the innovations we did. We didn't have the tool he was proposing to use to do the innovation. He was a visionary on cognitive radio. And in 1994, DARPA shows that software radio is reconfigurable. Note how long after we had already done it, DARPA does this. They're supposed to be leading innovation, and we were already doing it. We were changing. So I did the first demonstration of the DSP card I can remember was at the technology group that meets in Vienna. Meets in Vienna, Virginia. Paul Rinaldo was the head of
AMRAD.
I gave a demonstration at AMRAD of PSK being brought into the DSP card and turned into FSK by DMOD, REMOD, so that I could read it on a TNC. And that was how the first PSK modems were done for the existing TNCs. Okay, so look, I contend that this is about the last major innovation done by amateur radio operators. I'm happy to be corrected. I hope you correct me. I hope I'm wrong. But this is the last I could find where innovation was done by amateur radio operators. Wireless companies have left us behind. They don't do single sideband FM and CW. And only recently have we begun the very slow turn to digital. Now, what is the cause of this slow turn to digital? It's going to be in a massive way now. What's the deal?
I mean, why is there a delay?
No, I know why the delay is, and I know why the delay is over.
Well, the cost of play the game is expensive.
Yes, exactly right. The cost to play the game is expensive. I already have it up here. Oh, yes. This is a major deal. Truly, truly major deal. The Raspberry Pis, I can put a TNC together with John's kit, which I have in my home, and a Raspberry Pi, and it's like, you know, $75.
But to do your 1,000-channel stuff, it still requires a $10,000.
It does. It does. It absolutely does. That's exactly right. So, again, that won't be for everybody. But this can be for everybody. This is the Red Pitaya. Everybody goes and looks at the Sherwood engineering table because they want to see where their receiver is. They want to know they got the best thing. So the Red Pitaya would be number 5 or 6 on the Sherwood engineering table. So this.
Tell them what it is.
Okay, I am. I'm getting there. So it's really super duper. Now let me tell you. She does this to me all the time. We're used to it. Okay, so it's an A to D and a D to A running at 125 megasamples a second. And from there, it goes into... Exactly. It goes directly from there into a field programmable gate array that's married intimately to an ARM processor. You've heard ARM FPGA over and over and over here this past couple of days. It's a Zynq 7010. And hooked to two inexpensive but high performance A to Ds and D to As. This whole thing, fifth on the table, full duplex, two full duplex radios. That's two inputs, outputs. So you do MIMO, phased arrays, whatever. Two to operate on two different frequencies. This SDHC card right here, the kind you put in your camera, on it is 9 bands of whisper. That's from low kilohertz all the way up to 6 meters, all simultaneously. Absolutely done simultaneously on every band. And you can transmit one, so you pick it. So you transmit one, you receive them all. Transmit one, when your time slot comes to transmit, you transmit, and on almost every band except the one that you're transmitting on, this receiver will still work because it has very high dynamic range and fairly low phase noise. Okay, so this is a major innovation.
Tell them how much it costs.
Oh, $250.
It's a 12-bit ADC.
Yes, yes. So let me explain to you. You can go 20 log to the 12th and realize that is not 90-something dB. Okay. Inside the FPGA is mathematical magic. The mathematical magic is called filtering and downsampling. So every time you do the filtering and downsampling, you downsample. So if it's 125, let's divide that by 4 and make it a slower sampling rate in software. The available increase in dynamic range is 1 bit. Every downsampling by 4 increases the dynamic range by 1 bit. So 2 to the 12th becomes 2 to the 13th. 2 to the 13th becomes 2 to the 14th. 2 to the 14th becomes 2 to the 15th. And by the time they get done here, it's 2 to the 16th, and 20 log of 2 to the 16 is 90-something dB. Okay? Right, 90 dB. And it's been measured. Okay, so that's a big deal.
And OpenHPSTR has been doing that for 10 years.
Yeah.
Is that standalone, or sits on top of a Raspberry Pi?
Nope, standalone, and it has a gigabit Ethernet port. It's an Ethernet appliance, Internet appliance. Okay. Okay, so mobile devices.
Yeah. What do you call it?
It's Red Pataya. So www.redpataya.com.
You'll see it.
P-A-T-A-Y-A.
And P-A-7-T, Pavel Demin, did all of the software-defined radio code. One person did all of it. Okay, so let's go to mobile devices now. 1949. We had the mobile telephone service was introduced by AT&T, and ooh, it had 500 customers.
Well, 5,000.
5,000, yeah. Oh, give or take a factor of 10.
It's a factor of
10. It's a factor of 10 between friends. At 1965, they improved the mobile telephone service, and more channels, customers, and it was like 30,000 people used it, and within 30 minutes of New York City, you could use it. 1973, handheld mobile phone was produced at Bell Labs, and it was about that big, but it was handheld. And 1979, 1G analog, including amps in the United States, came along. So now you've got your FM telephone, but it switches from one tower to the next as you drive from one tower to the next. It did the automatic switching. So you could go way down the road, and you could keep your phone call almost. Almost. Not quite, but almost. Then we had digital come on. So the 1990s began the digital communications things in mobile phones. 2G or digital cellular, which had vocoders. That means take the voltages from your voice that are coming into an A to D and turning that into a digital representation. And the digital representation is transmitted over the air. At the other end, the digital representation comes into the phone, turned back into a voltage through a D to A and out to the speaker, okay? 2001, 3G broadband digital and WCDMA came along, Andy Viterbi and the people at Qualcomm figured out how to make it work. So code division multiple access was a big deal, but that was not even close to enough. They had to solve an ugly thing called the near-far problem, which was they did by having a phone that was really close to the cell tower transmit lower power so the people further off could transmit higher power and still be heard by the tower. Yeah. Yes, yes, he did. Yes, okay.
There's actually more to that story. The first 2G handheld cellular was the...
Was the Motorola Dynatac. And its importance was that it turned what was the telephone company's mobile service into a handheld service that we know and appreciate today, handheld radios.
Yep.
And that, I think, was a much more dramatic turnaround and a bigger impact on the industry.
Well,
of course,
it's a bigger
they didn't
impact.
Follow through with digital.
It's a really huge, big impact on our lives. How many of you go anywhere without your cell phone?
Yeah.
I mean, you take your business, daily business, into the bathroom with you. I mean, just amazing.
Yeah.
Basically, what that was going from high tier, high locations to low tier, where you had frequency reduced.
Yep. Exactly. So all of the hard problems, I was just going to skip over it, but thank you. I was glad to have you all, you smart people in here. The implementation of everything, this packet switching is what we're really talking about there. Moving from cell to cell, switching your packets throughout the early internet, so it would go from the right cell where you are to the right cell where the person you're talking to is. All of this was very cleverly done in some neat packet switching networks. And as I was saying, Andy Viterbi solved the problem of near-far and CDMA to make it to increase. No one at the FCC for years believed Andy Viterbi's capacity calculations. So they made Qualcomm demonstrate it. So Phil Karn and Paul and others, they got out, Paul, KB5MU, they got out into a truck, ran around, transmitted CDMA to the digital towers at Qualcomm, and proved by a demo that Andy Viterbi's near-far power agility and CDMA would work. And so they got 5 megahertz channels where everybody else was trying to give me 20, 30, 40, 50 for amps, even digital amps, and Andy Viterbi Qualcomm swept everybody in the U.S. out of the way. Okay, because Spectrum even then was under a crunch. It was definitely because mobile, everybody thought, well, maybe this mobile's going to take off. And then Qualcomm did something else interesting. Everybody has a smartphone? Yeah, most of you? Well, Qualcomm did one of the first ones. They certainly did the one that sold the most. They had mobile IP. They had CDMA with a reasonable data rate. You had low expectations for data rate back then, but it was data to your phone in the car. And so they did the smartphone. Qualcomm is tremendously important to this. Okay, so 2010-ish, we needed more capacity. The demand for capacity for digital communications is just kept growing and growing, and we had this ugly problem called multipath, and it really needed to be solved. And the solution was, if I have signals that are transitioning very quickly, remember, they're very wide. So if I have digital data that's going 0-1, 0-1, 0-1 very, very fast, then I need a very wide channel to transmit it. And unfortunately, multipath, which is a reflection off of surfaces, et cetera, is highly frequency dependent. So because things go in phase and out of phase, but they do that by then that in phase and out of phase, constructive and destructive interference, which you commonly hear on FM and call it picket fencing. Picket fencing is this, and they add and they disrupt, but it's frequency dependent. So you don't want something wide when the picketing is going to clobber it. You want something narrow. So what did they do? They took one narrow channel and said, shoot, if one narrow channel is good, how about 1,000 narrow channels side by side? And that's exactly what this is. 1,000 or so narrow channels side by side, changing very slowly compared to everything else. And so that's what made it. So This is demodulated using a Fourier transform, and it's modulated using an inverse Fourier transform. So it's just kind of neat. So the OFDM era was born around 2010-ish. I mean, it's almost hard to imagine. I remember the first time I got an LTE phone, I thought this is a miracle, except the towers were not all turned on. So it was doing 3G when I wanted 4G. But anyway, it worked, and the swap over was rough, but it worked. But it's hard to believe that was 6 years ago. It's just time is just flooding us. So this the future shock of innovation that Alvin Toffler wrote about, it's here. Okay, so let me keep going, or I won't get through all this. Regulation in the U.S., 1910 to 1920, interference made regulation a necessity. 1920s, an independent commission regulated broadcasting, and you know what that was. That was how many bribes can you take under the table and everything else. So that wasn't going to work. So they passed the Radio Act of 1927. They wanted ship to shore and vessels in distress were receiving interference from everywhere, but hams were particularly bad. There was the wild. They needed to recover from the wild, wild west of radio, where anybody could be anywhere. But they figured out they made a bunch of mistakes in this thing. So they redid it and formed the Communications Act of 1934, and an independent agency was born to do spectrum allocation. Decide what could be transmitted on what channel. There were lots of engineers at the FCC back then because they needed to be, because this was all new, unique innovation, so lots of engineers. My favorite story is I went to the FCC with AMSAT folks because they were making a real pain about debris mitigation. So you need to maintain standing in order to fight them, so we went to the FCC. We told them we were going to fight them. And the private radio bureau guy sat us down at the table. We were talking about their debris mitigation stuff for amateur satellites and what a bad thing it would be for amateur radio satellites because we couldn't afford all this debris mitigation stuff. So the head of Big Honcho sitting at the head of the table introduced this young guy on the back wall. And the young he made it a point to introduce this guy saying he's a ham and is an electrical engineer. His only purpose was, see, we have hams and engineers at the FCC. So we went through our meeting. They figured out they could not bully us. We would not back down. We were going to fight their right to implement debris mitigation. Later, and they failed. They had to go to Congress and have the law amended to do debris mitigation. Okay, so, and we were the cause of them failing and having to go to Congress. Okay, so we were leaving the building. A little kid runs up to a couple of us and he says, so happy to meet you. Thank you for coming. I read your this and that and the other. The typical young kid who's been wants to see the people he's read about that do stuff. And then he apologized. He says, I need to apologize. I says, what for? He says, yes, I'm a ham, but I'm not an engineer. I'm a lawyer. They could not find an engineer in the building to act as a wallflower in this meeting. Okay, so that tells you what's going on with the FCC now, and it's gotten worse. Okay, so 1987, the fairness doctrine was abolished, and if you hate mainstream media, look at 1987. That is where it all went to hell. Fox News, MSNBC, all these other things, they were not possible before the fairness doctrine was ended. This partisan stuff that goes on television, right there, that ended it. That one act had so many unintended consequences, it's not funny.
It started. Those are cable channels. I thought fairness doctrine was never...
But they were planned. But the fairness doctrine the FCC still regulates the fairness doctrine, even on cable. Yeah. But they did. But anyway, but on air... You still have safe zones and other stuff, but the partisanship is still there. There are obvious biases on mainstream regular TV. Whether it's liberal or conservative, there are biases. You can see them. But the fairness doctrine, you do not have to sit down with your opponent and have a conversation. You can set a one-sided stream of junk, and there's no law, regulation, whatever, that says you have to present both sides. Well, They made it. They made a mistake, in my opinion. Okay, so here it is. This is the big deal. This is the insanity. So what is this like? What does this look like to you? It looks like a land map. And that's exactly what it is like. It's a land map. The way licensing is done now is that little block right there, we're not going to try to read it. But over here, it tells you who owns it. That block is owned by light blue, whatever light blue is. And brown is that little block, whatever that is, that owns all the little brown blocks. So they can't change. And it's ridiculous what they have to do to change stuff. Okay, so here's what's happening. These mobile devices, they're unbelievably awesome. You love your smartphone. And what are you receiving on them now? Almost all the time. Crap. But in what format?
Cat videos.
Huh? Cat videos. And any kind of video. So they've done everything they could to squish it through some kind of compression. But still, over 80% of all the data transmitted on the internet is video. It's being compressed as much as it can because you demand high definition, even on your screen that big. Okay, you still want 4,000 pixels on a screen that big, so you're going to get it, but this is the result. This is the result. Right about now, it's 4 etabytes a month, and by 2030, it'll be, 250 times that. That is an exponential curve if ever I saw it. We won't get there if we don't do something, because this is how much capacity, information capacity, as measured through the independent variable we have under our control, we can do. Spectrum is the independent variable that will determine communications capacity. How many bits can I cram through the channel? And you need frequency, assignment, or something else, spectrum sharing. It now costs $636 million per megahertz to find a piece of frequency for your mode. That is unsustainable, and we're about to run out. So the FCC is trying spectrum sharing for the first time, and Federated Wireless, as I told you, is doing it. Yeah.
The chart on the bottom, there's another very interesting aspect to it. As time goes by, there's lots of unsold spectrum, which points to this is an unstable market and unstable auctions,
yep,
with some people actually paying these prices, and then the government standing around going, what? I have unsold spectrum? So there's problems underneath.
Yep.
There's problems all over.
Well, and we had a question earlier about what I will call a slumlord of large blocks of frequencies. They're slumlording it. What industry am I talking about? Nope. Cellular is using everything they've got and they want more. TV. So almost.
They're only fashion channels by that number are worth $3 billion each.
Yes, they're slumlording their TV. What they're doing is these TV transmitters are expensive. So you know what they're doing? They're taking their 100-watt transmitter and they're hooking it up to an aerial, and because that keeps them active on the channel, and they know that everybody that watches that thing, except for the relays out to the boondocks, are watching it over streaming, over cable, or streaming off the internet. I can watch WDBJ Channel 7 streaming on my phone, or I can watch Netflix or Hulu. I don't need those TV transmitter channels, but they are waiting around until they will be allowed to sell them and make billions of dollars. At $635 million, all those TV channels will be worth a lot of money. All right, let's stop for a minute for questions, and then we'll take a break. Yes, Tom?
So what I'm getting from your talk and Michelle's talk is that we need some kind of a clean sheet of paper approach to all this, where we use time, frequency, location, propagation, and code modulation schemes, along with, you know, whatever cognitive stuff we can put into place, right?
So we need something new, and I'm going to tell you my prediction of what the new thing is. And the new thing is everything you're mentioning.
Yeah. Did I miss anything? That's the question.
Yes, and I'm going to go over it.
Okay.
I'm going to go over it. I promise you I'm going to go over it. I'm
okay.
Going to introduce something brand new to you, but it is the solution to a lot of these problems.
So
and it's on. Yeah, the anthropometrically median ham still is clamoring for a return of code testing. How do you get people's heads out of that past and turn them around and make them look to the future that we're going to lose it all unless we innovate and get
asked,
back in the game?
I asked Brennan yesterday an impolitic question. The impolitic question was, Brennan, can you describe the demographics and the impact of it on amateur radio? And I'm being practical. People who are 55, 60 and older, we're setting our ways. We want to do certain things certain ways. We're busy. We're working. We have families. We're doing whatever we need to do to get through the day. And, you know, maybe we have all this money we've invested in equipment. We don't want to lose that investment. The innovation that we need in amateur radio will come about one way. The same way it did when all of us got in here and innovated. We were young. We were foolish. We were crazy. We did junk that people told us, you can't do that. And we went, oh, hell yeah, we can, and we're going to. Okay, that is how innovation was done in amateur radio. Young people who thought bigger than they should be allowed to think, then the thing that enabled them to do it, the thing that enabled them to do it was amateur radio's freedom. And it's the ultimate democratic assignment of frequencies in the world. Amateur radio is an international asset, and we are going to lose it if we do not get out of these desks, go to schools, and figure out how to get young people back into it. You've got the tool. The Raspberry Pi costs $30, and the RTL SDR costs $30. You can show them radio for $60. $60, you can give away a radio to a kid. And not only that, the tools are becoming really easy. You don't need to know DSP to do a radio. You don't need to know it at all. You need to get a book that has a block diagram of a radio. And do you know in GNU Radio? You can take that block diagram in the radio, put it on the block diagram tableau called GNU Radio Companion, hit go, and you've got a brand new radio. And then you go, hey, wait a minute. That's neat. What if I tinker with this? You can tinker with the nuisance parameters. You can change the order of the blocks. You can try different blocks. You can learn radio without having to learn DSP, and it's easy. Yeah.
To quote Lowell Johnson and slightly paraphrase, I've been coming to DCC for 19 years now, on and off, and back then I was around the youngest person coming. I'm still about the youngest person coming.
So in AMSAT, I was the youngest director ever, and I'm not the youngest now. There are a couple that are younger than me, but they're not that much younger. There's a gap. There was kind of a gap where society changed. Society changed, and we're not gonna undo these changes because families have both parents working. There are a lot of single parent families, and their kids will not be introduced to the things we were introduced to, the same way we were introduced to them in the safety of our homes where mentors came, because we're kind of afraid now to go out and deal with kids because we might be accused of something. We need to figure out how to work that out. We need young people in amateur radio, or we are moribund.
Maybe we should change the thrust to try to get education to include this as part of the STEM.
So I bragged up here a bit about Phil Karn. Phil Karn did a lot at Qualcomm, and he went through some struggles with disease, including cancer, and he's come out the other side of that, and now Phil is taking... His number one focus right now are the kids. He's going into high schools, showing them how to take radio and put them on weather balloons. He launches them over the Salton Sea multiple times a year. He's showing them right now. He's taking a raspberry. He messages me multiple times a day, interacting with me about doing the Raspberry Pi and RTL SDR dongle and the code that he's going to show the kids in the high school. So you can do it. I mean, you won't have Phil's resources. I mean, he was there long before Qualcomm explosion. You won't have his resources, but you can find somebody like Bill with some resources. Work it out. Get up out of your desk and work it out so we can get these kids in amateur radio. I'm the luckiest guy in this room, unless some of you are at a technical university. At Virginia Tech, I get to work every day with 18 to 22 or 3-year-olds, and they are eager. They are absolutely eager. And all I had to do, because I'm allowed to by law, I try to influence some of them. And there are people around me, I told you, they are curious. They want to do stuff. And they are droving to amateur radio because we're building a satellite ground station that's one of the premier ones in the world. And I'm lucky. This is just, I lucked into it. Yeah.
Let's get this guy in.
Bob, on a smaller scale, the amount of people that have purchased the ICOM 7300 and the nets that are 30, 40, 70 deep of these operators that are all peers of ours and some is also a smaller change that is going forward, because that has driven an awful lot of RTL sales. And
yes,
it's a smaller part forward. But we can leverage, and I'm hearing this from Rob, and I'm hearing it from Bob Heil, that leverage that into going to the youth and saying, look what we can do. Yep. Look what we can play with.
Yep.
So the guys in our club that are absolutely married to their monster box, big knob radios whatsoever, it's kind of a shame that you bought an FTD 5000X at Dayton last year, and you're already on Sherwood's report somewhere below.
Yeah. So, companies have to make money. They're in the business to make money. So Flex gave up on its computer screen because the contesters wouldn't use it. And contesters are now driving most sales of HF gear. They tell us what's good. Sherwood tells us what's good. And they talk about workflow and so forth. And so Flex came out with a knob and a front panel. It's a fancy one. It does really, really neat things, like I can walk around my house and work a single sideband or Morse code and not have to be near the radio with this thing called the Maestro. So, I mean, companies want to make money, they're innovating to make money. Yes?
The TAPR board over the last few years had some discussion about aligning with the maker movement. I noticed in Friedrichshafen, the Dayton of Germany, over the last 2 or 3 years, they've aligned their schedule with the maker fair.
Yes.
And that seems to be a real interesting place to maybe get new recruits.
Yeah, that's what I was going to interject, is that the maker movement.
If you're wondering where all the younger hams are, they're at maker fairs. And one of the maybe more irritating things about the schedule for Dayton Hamvention is that it's usually the same weekend as one of the biggest maker fairs in the United States. Having to choose between the two is kind of a downer. So now that there's bunches of maker fairs all over the place, getting active in your local maker fair is extraordinarily awesome. You meet lots of young hams. There's learn how to solder stations. It's a big deal. Plow into it, and you will meet all the people that are not joining TAPR anymore, change their mind.
In the dormitories at Virginia Tech, there's a maker lab in every dormitory with soldering irons.
Yeah,
machines,
it's a big deal.
Woodworking, DIY, do it yourself. You see ARRL trying to do it at Dayton. So DIY and maker is kind of neat. So there's lots of neat stuff you can do with this little radio.
Bob,
if you go look at
it. The thing that you guys mentioned earlier about STEM and getting more active in STEM, the biggest barrier to really cool stuff being in the curriculum is the curriculum designers. What they really, really want, what classroom teachers really, really need, is for you to give them something that is prefabbed. They really do rely heavily on things like worksheets. So open-ended experimentation and exploration, even though that's the way to learn, if you can possibly think real hard and make a real solid curriculum design or even a couple of lessons and make it easy for a teacher to do, then you can get into STEM. And STEM is where lots of activity and money and politics and fear and turf wars are going on right now. it's difficult to just show up and say, hey, look at this cool thing, that it's risky and weird and people will fail, and students failing, even though that's the way that they learn, there's a huge amount of resistance to that.
Well, if you're not helping them with the curriculum that teaches to the standardized exams, you're not going to break in. This is going to have to figure out how to do it as an extracurricular activity until all that stuff changes. Yes.
Yeah.
Let's do one more question.
Yeah, I was going to add on to that. I come from Suncoast Science Center and Suncoast Makers in Sarasota, and we have a STEM. We're associated with a STEM facility there, and the key is to getting to, like you say, to the teachers, not to the kids, because the access to the kids is through the teachers and through the curriculum you can do. So if you can go with where the teachers are and give them educational material, show them how to do these things with the radios and things like that, that's the way to get into it. And we just, kids from the age of 12 to about 22, we just did 8 new technical licenses and 2 made general. So
great.
Just last week.
That's so great. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
One quick observation. I noticed you have the innovation gap on one of your slides where, like, the last innovation from
and I might be wrong, but that's roughly right.
Yeah. So you see that related to the age gap of about 20 years?
There's that and the innovation, the internet and smartphones interrupted. That, so now it's, I got my smartphone, why do I need a ham radio? So that we need to figure out what to add on, bolt on to the experiences they have that will say, you know, it would be neat if I could do this. Well, you can't do that on a smartphone, but you can on this thing. And ham radio. We got to find stuff that they want to do that they cannot now do. Yeah, one more, and we need to take a break.
Hey, Brian Fields, W9CR. So there is, which is cool here, I went by the St. Pete Maker Movement place, whatever, here, dropped off some DCC flyers. I know we've had some interest from them. All these places, these maker movements and whatnot, I don't think I've run into there's the Tampa Bay Makers space over in Tampa. There's one here in St. Pete. They're all on Facebook. They're all on Twitter. They're all on social media sites. So I know this is a thing that a lot of hams don't have, is a, you know, even a Facebook account or, you know, some sort of a social media account. So, you know, that's how you have to reach people. Secondly, I'm, you know, as you know, I work with HamWAN. One of the things I have wanted to do, we've not had the opportunity to do it because we're still getting off the ground here in Tampa Bay, is to reach out to some of the high schools that do the, Cisco Academy programs and whatnot, where they take your, basically, I think it's juniors and seniors going into your, you know, program and learn routing and switching. This is something really cool we can offer and say, hey, We need people that know how to do this, but you have to be a licensed ham radio operator. This is another aspect of ham radio. And the third thing I'll say is probably, I don't know, I actually may be the youngest person here, and I've been the youngest person here for the past 20 years. okay, no longer. I didn't know Ryan showed up. And how do I say this nicely? You know, the question is, well, how do we get some of the FUDs, if you will, out of amateur radio, so that it's, you know, get out of the way and let the young people experiment.
There's plenty of room.
There
you
is.
You don't need to run anybody off.
I could beg to differ privately, but I think it's one of those things that just might be, you know, as time goes on, I've heard less and less about people complaining about code. I've heard more and more people reaching out, but, you know, a lot of our people believe this is a 45-year-old person's hobby. You know, it's the kids are out of the house, whatever, and we're done with it. And I think that perception needs to change.
Okay, we need to take a 5-minute break. I'll start back at again 11 to go through my last slides, because I'm going to tell you about the DARPA Spectrum Challenge and some other things, and then we'll and the thing that's going to sweep over radio in the next few years.